Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 28 of the 13 o'clock podcast.
Good episode today.
Good episode today. Hour of the weird and unusual. That's our little tagline, which I don't usually say.
No.
Before we get started, like I usually do, want to mention Project Entertainment Network, on which the audio version of our podcast is hosted. There's a bunch of other really cool podcasts on there, too. So if you want to check them out, and also they have a Patreon page at patreon.com/projectentnet if you want to go and give them a couple bucks. They have some cool shit to give out, postcards, buttons. I think eventually they'll have t-shirts and stuff too for patrons. So what are we talking about today?
Dyatlov Pass.
The Dyatlov Pass
incident. An old Soviet legendary tale of Arctic exploration. Well, yes. Not really Arctic.
Well, Arctic tragedy.
Yeah.
It is actually kind of a very sad story and a very creepy story.
Yeah.
And what we're going to do probably is I'm kind of just going to give a brief rundown of what happened, why people are so fascinated by it, like why it's creepy.
Yeah, the case has some weird evidence to this. I don't want to call it a crime scene. Let's just call it a scene. What happened there. It looks kind of weird.
Yeah, there are a lot of very weird, creepy details.
But, you know, in the end, I have some experience in cold weather expedition for military type stuff, which I'll get into that. And once again, Tom's going to blow this out of the water. No, but it's a good case. And I understand why people remember it and are fascinated with it. It is so weird.
Yeah, it is a pretty weird case.
Right. But so, Jenny's going to play the straight man. She's going to give it to you as it is.
Yeah.
What do they say it's like, Jenny?
Okay. Tell them to them. So basically, it's 1959.
Yeah.
In the Soviet Union. In the Ural Mountains.
Ural Mountains.
In the then Soviet Union.
Yeah.
There are a group of nine students. Most of them were university students. Generally engineering students, physics students, that type of thing.
Yeah, these are kind of the cream of the crop for Soviet citizens, you know. This is kind of like their equivalent of rich people.
Yeah, really? they were all members of a sporting club that did a lot of these types of cold weather hiking, skiing expeditions. They would usually go every winter on their school holidays.
Yeah, they're in their 20s now. We're real fit.
Most of them. The oldest one was actually a ski or a hiking instructor. He was 37. I remember, 38.
He was an army veteran who had survived the, Battle of Stalingrad. So he was a man. He was a man among men.
Yeah.
Tough guy.
So these were not inexperienced survivalist types. They had been on several of these expeditions before.
Yeah, they've been out before. Right.
And so this was just another one that they were doing.
Yeah, and what this was, I don't know if you guys know, some countries call it ski tourism. It's like hiking and skiing combined. The mountains aren't real steep, but they put on heavy backpacks ranging from 100 pounds to about 60 pounds. They put on skis, and they kind of run with skis. They're not going down slopes. It's like cross-country skiing.
Yeah. And then they're camping out. In the freezing cold
wilderness. And they were going to go across this pre-planned route. I think it ended up being close to 200 miles, huh? Like a big box.
It was, yeah. They actually, from where they took a train for 400 miles, like from the town they were from.
Yeah.
And then they kind of went out more and more remote until at some point, you know, they were staying in abandoned villages and then they kind of went the rest of the way on foot. I think it was about 180-mile trek. They were going to go to Mount O'Torton, I think that's how you say it.
Yeah.
And then they were gonna circle back around.
And this area is kind of a tribal area. They have these guys called the Mansi, I think.
Mansi.
And they raise reindeer. I guess
reindeer herders.
Yeah, reindeer herders. I've never seen one. I guess they're kind of like, you know, what they call the Inuit or the Eskimo or something like that. I don't think they're Caucasian people, are they?
I have no idea.
I don't think so. Anyway, they're out there and it's not mountains like the Sierra Nevada mountains or anything. It's kind of like big, gentle, rolling hills. That's what the terrain looks like. And it's cold. It's wintertime.
Cold as fuck.
Yeah, it can get down to, 50 degrees below zero, I think.
Yeah.
Actually, I think they said 60, 70 degrees below zero at night during certain times of the year.
Yeah. Yeah,
this is Siberian weather.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So these students, there were originally 10 of them.
Yeah.
But one of them got sick or got injured and had to go back before.
Yeah, he got blisters on his feet.
Yeah, or something like, or they said he had a leg injury. Yeah, I read some places to say different things.
I think it was blisters on his feet.
But he went back.
Yeah.
So the nine of them, it was seven men and two women.
Yeah.
And they continued on their way. Now, there are actually, and you can actually see it now, there's a documentary on YouTube that's in Russian language, but it, you know, it has English subtitles, and it actually shows all of the photographs and all of the journals,
yeah,
like the diaries that they were all keeping, because they were all taking pictures the whole time, they were writing in their diary what they did that day and all this other stuff, so they can track a lot of their movements.
Yeah,
it's
a very good documentary. It's almost kind of like a source documentary. It's all subtitled.
Yeah, it's like Russian. 2 hours.
It'll give you the feel. If you're really interested, you should go check it out. It's a good documentary.
Yeah. And so, like I said, they kind of have a lot of their original diaries, and they kind of read excerpts from them of what they were doing.
Yeah.
And it just sounded like a bunch of 20-year-old kids, you know, they're going off on the another expedition. And
yeah, they were good people.
Yeah,
good people.
Doing this and that. Now, what ended up happening... They were scheduled to return, not necessarily return, but they were, the leader of the expedition was Igor Dyatlov, after whom the pass is named.
Now.
Now it is. The pass did not have a name before, but after the tragedy happened, they actually eventually named it after him. But Igor Dyatlov, he was 23 years old, and he was kind of the leader of the expedition. He had been on either this exact route before or one very close to it, so he knew his way around. Now, he was supposed to contact his sporting club when they kind of got back to civilization. He was supposed to contact them on February 12th, but he told them, you know, it might be a few days after that because it's a difficult route. The weather was supposed to be bad. So they said, you know, don't panic if you don't hear from us for a few days after that. So February 12th comes and goes and no one hears from them. But no one was terribly alarmed because he had said that. They said, oh, you know, these expeditions sometimes run over. It's not that big a deal. Really, no one got terribly alarmed and started looking for them until February 20th. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they had search parties going out. You know, the families were starting to complain and stuff like that. So the search party went out to where, you know, they thought they were.
Right.
And it took about 6 days, I think. On February 26th, one of the search parties saw the remains of their tent.
Yeah.
The tent was all fucked up. It was covered with snow.
It was collapsed, covered with snow, and everything was in it.
And all of their stuff was in there.
And it had been
including
yeah.
all of their shoes.
All their shoes, everything. And it had been cut open on the side.
And it had been cut open from the inside.
Yeah.
And no one was in there.
And the exit to the tent was still at least partially buttoned shut. There's some, you know, some witnesses said no, it was
all the way buttoned.
All the way
some
shut.
Said a couple of the buttons right. were undone because it wasn't a zipper tent. It was right. a button up tent, and apparently it took a little while, you know, to open it.
Yeah.
So they found this tent with. That was cut open. Mm. Now, at first, they didn't know that it was cut from the inside. They just said there was a cut in the side of the tent.
They had it confirmed later through a seamstress that it was cut open from the inside.
That it was cut
open
from
the
inside.
That's not really important at this point. They were still just trying to find where they were.
Yeah.
Like, they were looking for the people.
Yeah.
They found them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not far from the campsite. Well, a little less than a mile from the campsite.
Yeah.
There was like a forest, like the edge of a forest, and there was a big cedar tree there. And at the base of the cedar tree, they found the remains of a fire.
Uh-huh.
And they found two dead bodies, two of the men.
Yeah.
The weird thing was that neither of them were wearing shoes.
Yeah.
Neither of them were wearing clothes except for, they say underwear, but the Russian documentary says long johns.
Yeah, long johns.
And in the picture, like on the YouTube video, I'll show some of the pictures.
They're wearing long johns.
Of the bodies and stuff. Yeah. It's kind of grim, yeah. but, you know, but it looks like they just had long johns on.
Yeah.
Which, you know, not good because it was 20, 30 below 20 zero.
It was 20 below zero, but that's not counting wind chill.
Yeah.
So we don't know how cold it really was.
Right.
Wind chill can really add to that.
Okay, so they found the two guys by the cedar tree. Also, the cedar tree had branches broken off of it up to about 5 meters. signifying that maybe someone had tried to, had climbed it. Right. Well, not tried to climb it. They did climb it.
Yeah.
Because a lot of the branches were broken off. Now, then they searched, you know, the area a little bit more after they found the first two guys. And between the tree and the camp, in a line, they found three more bodies.
Yeah.
Two men, one woman.
Right.
And they were kind of in a line. It said that their positions indicated that they were trying to get back to the tent.
Right.
These ones that were buried under a tiny little bit of snow. That's why they didn't see them initially. But, you know, it was only a few centimeters of snow. These were dressed better. I mean, they had some clothes on, but not heavy clothes.
And they didn't have any shoes on.
And they didn't have any shoes on either. And so they pretty much figured, I mean, these five, you know, they started an investigation. They took, they couldn't find the other four right away.
Oh, I thought it was only four that were.
No, five of them they found.
Five of them they found. Okay.
Now, these five obviously had died of hypothermia.
Right.
Later, it was found that one of them had a minor cracked skull.
In his skull, the base of his skull, right.
But they said it wouldn't have been enough to kill him.
No, it wasn't fatal.
You know, and other than that, combined with, like, the underwear and everything like that, it was kind of weird, but they just figured, you know, they froze to death.
Right. But they couldn't find the other four.
But they couldn't find the other four for a long time. They actually didn't find them until about, like, more than 2 months later. I believe it was the beginning of May.
Yeah.
Once the spring thaw had started.
And this is where it really gets strange.
This is where it kind of gets weird, because the other four bodies were found about 75 meters on the other side from where the forest line was, like from the cedar. These four bodies were buried under, what, about like 12 feet of snow?
Yeah, but they found them during the thaw.
And they found them during the thaw.
And they were in a ravine beyond the wood line. I think they said 25 yards inside the wood line, right?
Something like that. I can't remember the exact distance, but
none of these distances are very great. They're actually all pretty close together.
Yeah.
And if you were to see it on a map, you see their camp kind of higher up on the hill, and then bodies in a straight line. You know, they're spaced out, and, you know, like, but how long do you think that line was? Not even 700 meters, 700 yards, maybe?
Something like that.
And they're in a line pointing directly back at the camp. So, you know, pretty weird.
Yeah.
But the conditions of the bodies that that they found after the thaw, that was pretty weird. You can tell about that.
The four bodies that they found, like I said, they didn't find them at first because they were buried under a bunch of snow. They found them in a ravine. They had really horrible bodily injuries.
Yeah.
One of them had a fractured skull that looked like a fatal wound.
Yeah.
Two of them had cracked ribs.
Crushed ribs on the bottom.
Or crushed ribs, or like their chests were caved in.
Yeah.
One of the women, her tongue, her eyes, and part of her lips were missing.
Yeah.
Now, there are also a lot of other kind of weird little details that make this kind of a compelling and kind of strange case.
Yeah, this is what keeps this case alive.
Yeah.
The radioactivity.
Because had the first five victims, they died of hypothermia.
Right.
You know, that's not strange. But then when they found the other four bodies that looked like they'd been crushed, they said that the injuries they had looked like a car crash.
Right.
And also, not only were they wearing pieces of some of the other people's clothes, like the woman had like part of one of the other guy's wool pants like wrapped around her foot.
Right.
But some of the articles of clothing were radioactive.
Right.
Now, there's also, and I mean, after this whole thing happened, and there is like millions of theories about this, and a lot of people have a lot of conspiracy theories about it just because of these kind of weird details.
Yeah, some people claim that there were orbs in the sky that night, orbs of light.
People claim to have seen like fire orbs in the sky. Yeah. Not necessarily saying it's UFOs. I think some people have said that. Yeah.
Some people were, is it rockets? Is it UFOs?
Some people thought that it was maybe a military cover up because evidently some people said the KGB was acting really shady about the case and trying to cover things up.
Some people suspected that maybe the Mansi tribes had cut in through the tent and chased them out and somehow killed them and cut the girl's tongue out. But
like all kinds of these types of things. And
the legend got bigger and bigger.
Yeah, and it seemed to get bigger and bigger. And like I said, it seemed like this happened in 1959. Like I said, I'm not sure if I mentioned that. And really, it didn't start to become like a huge story around the world until the 90s, because that was when the original case files finally got released.
Yeah.
Because apparently before that, it had been classified or whatever.
Yeah. Well, I think it was known about locally.
Well, yeah, the Russians knew about it, obviously. They had a memorial to them and all this other stuff.
The fall of the Soviet Union, I think, a lot of cool stories out of Russia started to leak out. And I think the UFO community got a hold of this. That's what I think.
Probably.
And the Yeti community, because there was...
Oh, yeah, that was another theory that they were killed by the Russian Yeti.
By the Russian Yeti.
They even made a Discovery Channel documentary. I hesitate to call it that. Yeah. But, they made a thing that maybe the Russian Yeti got them.
Yeah.
Right. And like I said, another one is that, the KGB were testing things and they actually blew the people up accidentally.
Yeah, that a rocket exploded.
And then tried to cover it up.
Right.
You know.
Pieces of a rocket were found in the area, but nowhere near where these bodies were.
But not near where the bodies were found.
No. So, it's just a bunch of, it's a bunch of bull.
Well, the thing about this case, and like I said, I find this case fascinating just because it's creepy. It's always creepy whenever you like find bodies and there's like weird little details that
don't seem to add
that
up.
Don't really seem to make sense. And you're just like, that's why I was like so interested. Like when we did the case about the Somerton man and all that other stuff, like about that rolled up piece of paper in his pants pocket and all. Like, I love shit like that.
Yeah.
Like, and it sucks because 99 times out of 100, it probably had a completely mundane explanation.
Yeah, it does.
Generally it always does. But it's like, it's just weird because you don't know what that explanation is or why that happened that way.
There are guys that have written books about it. Even if the books are interesting and well written, still the books are kind of being sold as on the more mysterious aspects of it being hyped up. But if you really look at the details, they're kind of focusing in on misleading little details or facts that are not totally confirmed. For instance, things that coroners supposedly said.
Yeah.
Did they really say that? How good was this autopsy?
Right.
You know, because on one of the autopsies, they were talking about some kind of a red goo down inside the woman's stomach.
Yeah.
It doesn't really say it's blood.
Right.
The autopsies are probably done Soviet style, and this is way out in the country. These guys are just trying to get done for the night, so they're very general. I'm not sure, how much weight some of those autopsies could carry.
Yeah, and I mean, like I said, the documentary we watched yesterday, the Russian language one, they actually quoted extensively from the autopsy reports, and the autopsy reports were fairly vague in the way that they were just kind of like, they attributed the deaths of the four last people to a compelling force.
Right.
Which could mean anything, really.
Well, here's a good example. The autopsy says that the girl's tongue was missing.
Mm-hmm.
But it didn't say it was cut out or yanked out or if it had been eaten out or if bacteria got it.
It just said missing.
And it may have actually been in there. Maybe that guy just couldn't identify the tongue. It might have shriveled down and became freeze-dried or,
And it's interesting because, and I think we were talking about this earlier, like, I don't like to, like, piss in anyone's Cheerios or anything like that. Yeah. But it's like I said, 9 times out of 10, stuff that seems, like, super creepy and super mysterious, there's a totally mundane explanation. And a lot of times, it seems like people just want there to be like some creepy, mysterious, if they want it to be a Yeti, they want it to be a UFO, they want it to be a government cover up. Maybe it is a government cover up every now and then. Usually not. Yeah,
I don't think in this case. You have to look. Here's the thing. I've seen things that were paranormal. I know they exist, you know. But you can't just go invent some paranormal.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? There's enough paranormal out there already. We don't have to start making any more.
Making up paranormal.
Making up paranormal. You know, just because it looks kind of weird doesn't necessarily mean paranormal. And I have some experience regarding Siberian winters, and I'm going to tell them in the second half.
Yeah.
But I can pretty much wrap this up. I know what happened.
Yeah. I mean, we're going to say...
In general, there's a lot of little details that, hey, you know, it's, I'm not going to... No one will know. No one will be able to answer some of these little details because we weren't there.
Yeah.
But in general, I know what happened.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, you know, there's fucking millions of theories about what could have happened to these people. I forgot to mention there was also one that was like infrasound. That was like, and that for evidence, I think somebody somewhere like posted a picture of like some snow that was like in a weird swirl pattern. And it was like, yeah, the military was experimenting with infrasound and it made them go batshit and all this other stuff. And, you know, and then there was other shit. Like there was shit from the, Wasn't there something from the autopsy that said like their skin was orange
somebody that saw their bodies? Yeah, one guy had a strange orange tan.
Like they were all orange and stuff like that. So I kind of feel like they're taking these weird
little bit of blood around the mouth.
Yeah.
Can I say that?
Yeah.
And there's an explanation for that.
Yeah, there might be an explanation for that, like in what we're kind of thinking and what we're going to talk about next, but I, you know, it's just like, it's a sad enough story. It's a creepy enough story.
Right.
You know, these people, and actually I think to me, the creepiest thing about it is looking at all their pictures and like reading their diaries.
Right.
And being like, these people didn't know that they were going to be dead in a few hours. That's what creeps me out.
Yeah. For the first part of this, you know, this was basically the setup. And to do a really good setup on this story, it takes hours, and there's some good ones out there. We're assuming that most of you guys listening know this case.
It's a pretty, pretty well-known case. Like several other podcasts have covered it. There's a bunch of books about it. Fucking Rennie Harlan made a fucking horrible, I don't know if it's horrible. The parts I saw looked horrible. made a movie in 2013 that was called, it's either called Dyatlov Pass or it's called The Devil's Pass.
I think it's Devil's Pass, isn't it?
But it wasn't like so much about that. It's kind of like a Blair Witch situation where like modern day people go back to this site and then the same shit happens. And I think there was monsters I saw in the trailer and parts and I don't know. It looked lame, so I didn't watch it. But, so it's a fairly, since the 90s, it's a fairly well-known case.
Yeah.
And it's still unsolved.
Yeah, technically it's unsolved.
Technically it's unsolved. I just personally, I don't think there's anything supernatural about it for sure. And I don't think there's anything mysterious about it.
Well, there are certain things you're never going to know, like the order in which they died.
Yeah.
That's going to be difficult to
you know.
How clothes got disseminated between them. There's things, there's little details like that where you'd have to be there to know.
Yeah.
But in general, I mean, I know what happened, man. They got cold.
Yeah, that's pretty much the size of it
They got cold, yeah.
But so before we do, let's take a break real quick, and then when we come back...
I need to take a hit off this mod here.
Okay.
Man, that's good. I know everybody back there, man. I hope he doesn't start vaping.
Now you're just doing it just to spite
people.
I'm
going to do it to spite you people.
Yeah. That's what I mean. So you don't complain about something that he's going to do.
Yeah, in the second half here, I'm going to tell you what happened at Dyatlov Pass, and I'm going to tell you why.
Well, we're going to tell you what our theory about it was. And it's not just our theory. It's kind of...
We studied other people's
theories about it and what we thought sounded the most plausible to us. But, you know... So and then Tom will probably relate some of my
military experience,
some of his military
in that cold weather environment,
similar kind of terrain. Yeah. So we're going to take a break right now. We'll be back in just a few minutes.
Every person's story has something to teach us: how others view life, how obstacles are overcome, how joy is felt, how fears are faced, how love is expressed. The Matters of Faith podcast explores individual stories of people's lives and how faith plays a part. It may not be your story, but it may help shape yours.
Matters of Faith podcast with Jay Wilburn is on Project Entertainment Network.
Subculture Corsets and Clothing is our favorite store for unusual clothing, shoes, and accessories. They offer a wide selection of men's and women's clothing at great prices. Subculture also offers a cool selection of shoes and accessories. Steampunk, gothic apparel, retro, corsets, and so much more at Subculture Corsets and Clothing. Check out Subculture online at subculturecorsets.com. That's subculturecorsets.com. Make sure you use the discount code 13O'Clock for a 10% discount. Subculturecorsets.com or visit their store in Jacksonville, Florida, just off I-95.
Armcast, Dead Sexy Podcasts. I'm your host, Armand Rosamilia. Fridays exclusively on Project Entertainment Network, where I interview authors, publishers, editors, artists, filmmakers, narrators, the lady from Walmart, whoever I feel like talking to. That's every Friday, Armcast, right here on Project Entertainment Network.
Hollow Earth, graphic design by Jenny Ashford. Specializing in posters and flyers. Special rates for bands and artists. Quick turnaround times. Books and CD covers. Consultations through email or Skype. Logos and packaging. Payment through PayPal. Ads and promo materials. Satisfaction guaranteed. Visit the Facebook page at Hollow Earth Design or email hecate80@hotmail.com.
Okay, and we're back.
Yep.
Now, we're not saying, like I said, we're not experts. I'm not Keith McCloskey over here who has studied the Dyatlov Pass incident for years and years and has written a couple books about it. We did listen to a couple of his interviews and read some of his stuff. And I think he's kind of on the right track. He maybe has a little bit of a little too much of a cloak and dagger.
You gotta sell books, you know.
Going on. But from everything we read about this case, we have kind of put together what we think is the most plausible scenario for what happened to these poor people.
Right.
So.
Well, let me go ahead and.
Yeah, you. Let me go ahead and lay this out. All right. He's going to drop his nuts now, like in an auditory.
In an auditory fashion. All right. I was part of a unit called the 1st and the 506 Air Assault Infantry Unit. This is back in the early 1990s. If any of you guys ever seen Band of Brothers, that was my unit that I was in. And I was in it in the early 90s during the first Gulf War when it was stationed in Korea, right up there with the DMZ overwatching North Korea. There was only one regiment to the 1st and the 506, and it's the DMZ regiment. And duty in Korea for infantry up there on the DMZ is absolutely brutal, especially in the winter. We had that same exact winter that you'd have up there at the Dyatlov Pass, which is the Siberian winds. It gets cold. But we had it even worse. It was jagged mountains. Korea is just steep mountains, and in the valleys, it's rice paddies. And we would go out, and we had an annual exercise. It was a massive one. It's the one you always hear about on the news called Teams. We called it Team Spirit back then, but it was the annual mobilization, and it's in the dead of winter, and North Korea hated it. It would regularly get at night around 50 degrees below zero. The equipment that we slept outside the whole time when you're infantry. And you do it in teams, and you learn to survive in that Arctic cold. We carried our own body weight. It's about 135 to 150 pounds worth of equipment. And a lot of people don't think you can carry that much, but you can. All right. If it's spread out on your body, you know, the equally distributed, you know, rucksacks and LBVs, but all that shit's technical. All right. So you learn quickly about how deadly and how dangerous cold is. and what the symptoms of hypothermia are. And I've personally experienced it myself. When you get cold enough and exhausted enough, you actually hallucinate. You lose the ability to think clearly. Now, in this particular case, I think that was a major cause of this disaster, was the inability to think clearly. And it's all because of cold. What I believe happened was, is that they set that tent up on a slope, and the first thing they did was that they leveled it. And when you level out the snow, it's going to leave maybe like a little 1 or 2 foot high wall of snow as it goes up the hill. You know what I'm talking about? Because you have to kind of level it. They put the tent there. That was the first problem. The second problem was is that they had a stove inside.
Like a furnace to keep it warm.
Yeah, it would heat the inside of the tent and they could cook on it. Any modern person now knows that you never have an open flame inside of a tent.
And if you see like the pictures of the tent, because they did take pictures of the tent set up and everything like that. So if you see that pipe, that's the vent pipe.
Right.
For their heater, for their furnace.
And things like that malfunction. Okay. So there's a danger of smoke inhalation. There's a danger of carbon monoxide poisoning. And because they've tried to level an area on a slope, you now have the danger of a small snow slide sliding into your tent. Okay, so there's a bunch of little risks right there. What we do know that happened is that they were forced out of the tent.
They must have been.
Something forced them out of the tent. They couldn't go out the normal way. All right. So somebody had a knife handy and cut their way out of that tent.
So it must have been something that happened suddenly.
At night when they couldn't see.
At night when they were sleeping and they didn't have any shoes on. They were half dressed.
Right. What could have happened is that carbon monoxide had gotten into the tent and they were all semi-conscious. Some of them maybe almost dying. All right. One guy cuts his way out and then he gets everybody out of the tent. And then maybe like the guys that were near the door to the tent where the snaps were, they pull him out and revive him. That's one thing that could have happened. Another thing that could have happened is that a minor snow slide came and knocked the tent over onto them. In other words, it collapsed the tent.
Yeah.
And they thought it was an avalanche. And I think that's probably the most likely. At night, a minor snow slide came, knocked the tent over. They thought they were in an avalanche. One guy in there thought they were going to get buried alive. He takes his knife and he cuts the tent open. Everybody comes running out. Now it's nighttime, 20 degrees below zero, not counting the wind chill. They're jumping up out of their rucksacks. Or not rucksacks, we got sleeping bags.
They've probably been sleeping. And we should note that a couple of them were intoxicated also.
Yeah, they'd been
in there drinking.
Right.
Because they were getting ready to go to bed.
So they come out of the sleeping bags just in their long johns, 20 degrees below zero. Then when you factor in wind chill, that might be 40 or 50 degrees below zero. And it's dark. They can't see. And before you know it, hypothermia, it hits them like lightning. That's what I think happens. And they probably ran down the hill to safety where the wood line was because they thought an avalanche was getting ready to happen. And they weren't thinking clearly. And they started to die. I think what happened was once they got down to the wood line, the ones that were crushed, I think they got to that ravine and were killed in a minor avalanche. And then they realized that they weren't going the right direction. So they tried to get back to the... Or that they realized that an avalanche wasn't happening. So they tried to get back to their tent. And some of them couldn't make it because their feet were too frozen. So they stopped at that tree and started a fire while the other three continued on to the camp. They said, leave us here. Come back. Bring us our sleeping bags or bring us our clothes. And the guys around the tree, they made a little fire. They ended up dying. The fire's not going to help you out in the open like that. And then the other three who were trying to get back to the camp died one by one. Now, some people are going, how do you actually die? Well, what happens is that you're walking, because I've been almost at that point. You're walking and all of a sudden you start to hallucinate and you kind of lose all your willpower, you know, and you just want to like lay down and go to sleep. And if you're around other people who are going through that same feeling at the time, they're going to let you go down and, you know, and lay down to sleep. And that's what happened to them.
Yeah. You know? And I mean, it should be noted too, okay, whatever made them, like I said, that really the only mystery is what made them cut the tent open.
Yeah, that's the only mystery.
Now,
really.
Like, some people are sitting there saying, like, okay, and I forgot to mention this earlier, but they found their cameras that they were still at the campsite, and they developed a lot of their pictures, and a lot has been made of the fact that the final picture on one of the guy's cameras was of, like, a black background with, like, these weird lights.
Yeah, it looks like orbs.
Yeah, that some people said, oh, maybe it was a UFO, or maybe it was a rocket blowing up. Maybe that's what startled them.
Nah.
Maybe, but see, I'm not really buying that.
They found that camera on a tripod inside the tent.
Right. So I'm saying whatever that picture was, it was probably taken inside the tent.
I think they were taking pictures of each other next to the fire.
Next to the furnace, and it was just too dark in there. It
didn't come out.
Because here's the thing. One, they were clearly all inside the tent. Most of them, they didn't have shoes on. Most of them were not, you know, some of them weren't dressed.
They didn't have shoes on. They were only in long johns. That meant that they were in their sleeping bags.
So they were either sleeping or they were trying to go to sleep. Like I said, a couple of them had been drinking. They were kind of inebriated. So they'd been in there hanging out, talking, drinking, whatever. And were probably, some of them were sleeping or on the way to be sleeping.
I think it happened while they were asleep.
It might have.
And it startled them.
And see, here's the thing. So that's why, and like I said, another thing that I think I forgot to mention was that when the search party found the tent, they found all of their footprints, like leading down toward the forest ridge line.
Yeah.
But they didn't look like, the footprints were not running. They just looked like regular walking in an orderly fashion.
Yeah, I'm skeptical of that because those footprints were old.
Okay. Yeah, that's true.
They were old. And it's hard to run anyway in certain types of snow.
Especially when you don't have any
shoes on. And then they're cold.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I don't really think they could tell if they were walking or running. They might have been trotting a little bit. Yeah. And it still would have looked like walking.
Because, like, I kind of suspect that, like I said, it must have happened in the middle of the night when they were sleeping or otherwise disoriented. It had to be something sudden. It had to be something that they thought was life-threatening because they were fucking up their tent.
Yeah.
So they either thought they couldn't get out the door or they really couldn't get out the door.
Well, they probably couldn't get out the door because there were guys laying down in front of the door and everybody's trying to get out at once.
Yeah.
Well, if you're trying to get out of a burning building, the best way out is through a window. Well, somebody had a knife handy. That's it. I'm going out through the side. And then that's a big opening. So that they all went out that side.
I mean, I kind of like the idea of the combination snow slide and then somehow that making the furnace malfunction. And maybe the tent filled up with smoke. So then they would kind of panic and be like, we need a vent, you know? Right. So then they would cut it open. And that would explain why after they crawled out, they might have just kind of stood around because they were coughing and trying to get their breath back.
Right.
And then it would have hit them, oh shit, we fucked our tent up.
Yeah.
What are we going to do now? And it was so cold that they didn't really have that much time to do anything.
Yeah, it doesn't take
now,
long.
Now, they think they were either heading for the forest because they thought it would be safer because they thought it would block them from a potential avalanche.
Yeah.
Or they were trying to get back to there. They had like a...
they had an emergency cache camp.
Like an emergency camp that was like about a mile away where they had extra skis, extra food, stuff like that. Because they were trying to get up this mountain and they hadn't got all the way.
They didn't want to take everything with them.
And they didn't want to carry everything up. They were just going to go up and come back down. So they don't know if they were like heading toward that or if they were just heading toward the forest.
I don't think there was a plan. I think they ran out of the tent because they thought an avalanche was happening. Smoke was getting them too. And they just started scattering down that hill.
Yeah.
And it took them a few minutes to get kind of organized to figure out what's going on. And they were probably separated.
Yeah.
By that time.
And like I said, they don't really know like which ones died first because like I said, the two guys that they found by the tree, Like I said, they had built a fire. These two only had long johns on when they found the bodies. The two guys they found by the tree branches were broken off like several meters up the tree, meaning that somebody climbed up there to break the branches either because they were trying to make a fire with the branches.
Or they were trying to see. I think they were trying to see.
Or they were trying to climb up there to see, like see where the camp was or see where the other people were.
Yeah, and you got to imagine that this is happening at night.
Yeah, it was the middle of the night.
And it may have been snowing, so visibility might have been very poor.
Because the last day of their photos and their diary, they said that the weather was getting bad and the visibility was bad.
You know, you look at the scene a few days later, okay, or you look at the map and you're looking at it with a clear head at the daytime and you're not imagining snow, poor visibility and panic and also exhaustion.
All right? Yeah.
Then you go, what the hell were they thinking? Well, my answer is they weren't thinking anything.
Yeah.
They were just trying to run for their lives. And then when they realized that they had screwed up, they were lost. They couldn't find their way back to the tent.
Right. Well, and because...
Or they didn't have time to get back to the tent because you're talking 20 degrees below zero.
Hypothermia sets in very quickly.
Exposed skin at that temperature, if you have a decent wind chill, you start to get frostbite within about 30 seconds, 40 seconds, just around the edges.
Yeah.
And that's just the very beginnings of frostbite, you know. Within, you'd be dead in probably about 30 minutes, 45 minutes. You start to hallucinate after probably about 20 minutes.
Yeah, it would not take long at all.
Yeah.
And like I said, by the time they all climbed out of the tent, realized what had happened,
yeah,
it might have been, they already might have started feeling the effects. They already might have started getting, kind of confused and things like that. And not, I mean, they seem to have some of their faculties in the sense that, you know, the two guys were like, we have to build a fire. Let's climb the tree and see where we are. Or get our bearings or whatever.
Yeah, and here's another thing. Before I forget. The radioactivity, that's bunk. The guys that had the radioactive clothing, it was beta radiation, evidently. They both worked in the nuclear weapons segments. They were helping to enrich uranium, I believe.
See, a lot has been made of... Now, I've even seen some sources that said the whole site was radioactive or all their clothes were radioactive. Yeah. Now, according to the Russian documentary and according to one other documentary that we saw about it, it was really only three items of clothes that had a higher than normal level of beta radiation. Mm. And those three items of clothing belonged to the two guys on the team who worked in a nuclear weapons plant or worked in that type of facility. So
that's total, so you know that's, where that came from.
So yeah, that's probably where that came from. It didn't have anything to do with aliens or military.
And the orbs, the orbs in the sky. I mean, this is the Soviet Union out in the middle of nowhere in the middle of the Cold War. You know, there's going to be some rocket testing.
Yeah.
That's probably all it was.
And like I said, even if that final picture was of like lights in the sky or something like that, it's like big deal.
Right.
And these students, like, it does seem like some of the people that are kind of going for the military cover-up angle are saying, well, you know, oh, maybe that's what startled them, or maybe a rocket crashed and it shook some snow loose or something like that.
Yeah, nah.
One, I don't think it would have startled them because they were all
educated.
Yeah, they were all educated. They all worked in those fields. They were engineering students, technical. They were all in, like, technical or scientific fields.
There's also no signs of any blasts or shock waves.
There's nothing like that. There's no footprints other than theirs.
Right.
Because some people, I think, thought, oh, the Mansi tribe killed them, but I don't know why they would.
Yeah, no motive.
No motive. I mean, they're just reindeer herders. They just live out in that area. They've lived there for hundreds of thousands of years.
Yeah, and they had no ill will towards,
And it should be noted, too, that even though this is a pretty remote area, it's a pretty popular area for hikers and skiers and things like that. So they had groups going through there, every winter.
Yeah, and these are basically Soviet elites. Nobody's going to mess with them in the Soviet Union.
Yeah.
KGB will be on you quick.
Yeah.
You know.
And that was another thing I don't really know. Like, I've never really seen any reason why the KGB would want to kill them, or if they accidentally kill them, why they would cover that up. Now, I said, if the KGB really wanted to cover that up, why would they leave all these there weird
would be
little...
No, there would be no bodies.
They would, yeah, they would just be no bodies. Say, oh, they well, finished. They must have just disappeared, just because that happens all the time.
Yeah.
That would be the easiest thing to do. Why leave bodies with all these weird details that don't really make any sense?
And then there's all, well, you know, they were running from something. Something scared them. Something scared... The only thing that scared them would have been maybe they thought they were in an avalanche. Maybe they were suffocating in there from
That's
from
what I mean.
Smoke,
it must have been something like
something,
that.
Something
alarming
mundane.
That happened in the middle of the night.
Dangerous but mundane.
Yeah, okay. That we need to get out of this tent.
Wasn't
right
polar bears or bears or animals, because there's no animal tracks. None of those bodies were eaten.
No.
There's nobody missing. They got them all. If it was bears, at least one of them would have been eaten.
Yeah. At least their limbs would have been torn off, and they'd have been...
Sure.
I mean, the injuries that they had...
They were all consistent with
being
crushed by a snowfall freezing to death.
That was another thing. Like, the first five obviously froze to death. I mean, I don't think anyone's disputing that. The four that they found later, the ones that had all these quote unquote weird injuries, that's pretty, actually what I think is that all four of them, they fell down in this ravine. I don't think they died right away.
I think they just got hurt and gave up.
But they got hurt because, you know, some of them had, one of them had bashed his head and one of them had like broken some ribs. And then they realized that they couldn't get out.
Yeah, and they were getting sleepy and cold and they were tired and they just said, fuck it, I can't do it. And they just, they fell asleep.
And honestly, I think most of the weirdest injuries,
the
like
eyes and the nose and
all that, I think that happened post-mortem.
Yeah.
I mean, and even a lot of the broken bones might have happened post-mortem, like from the weight of the snow falling, it might have
crushed the bodies, maybe. But I think the girl's head might have been in running water during the thaw.
Once
that,
the thaw started.
That will do damage. And you got to remember that the gruesome photos, the ones, you know, because there are photos of them, the gruesome ones... They were found 2 months after they were dead. They'd been out there for a long time.
Yeah.
And running water was involved at that time.
Yeah, because it was May. It was spring.
And that'll damage a body pretty quick.
Yeah.
And there are bacteria that'll eat up a body even at low temperatures, like 20, 30, 40 below.
Yeah.
If the right kind of bacteria gets on you, it'll eat you up.
And honestly, I think where a lot of the mystery comes from, too, is that people kind of focus on, oh, her tongue was missing. And I've seen, like, some sites say her tongue was ripped out or her tongue was cut out.
It doesn't say that.
No. All the autopsy reports says her tongue was missing. And I think it even mentions, and I think the coroners or the doctors even mentioned at the time that this probably happened post-mortem. It was probably a bacteria or something like that, because her face was in the water when it started to melt.
Right.
And, you know, the eyes and tongue either rotted out or bacteria ate them.
Yeah.
Because the other ones didn't have that, but their faces were not in the running water the way they were positioned.
Yeah.
And like I said, even the injuries could be consistent with being slowly crushed after they died by all the snow that
snow
fell on them.
Yeah, they may have not. Some have said that maybe they fell down in the ravine and got hurt and just laid there. Some people say, well, maybe they went over in a little mini avalanche and got buried. That both is plausible, but I kind of think they fell off down into that ravine, got so hurt, and they were so tired and disoriented and about half crazy from
because they walked quite a way.
They just gave up. And they died. And then they were there on the side. And there was something about that particular location where snow was being deposited there.
Yeah.
This may have happened during a bad snow squall. This whole episode. And they got buried.
Yeah.
And maybe something shifted and the weight of that snow just crushed them. You know.
Because I should note that
in areas. Didn't crush the whole body.
See,
but
that they're not exactly sure... Yeah. What day they died on. They think it was the night of February 1st, February 2nd.
Right.
Just because the diary entries, there are diary entries and photos like up to that day and there aren't any more after that. But they didn't find the bodies, they didn't find the camp until February 26th. So even the initial five that they found had been out there for about 3 weeks probably.
Yeah.
And then the other ones... You know, the other ones they didn't find till May the 4th, I believe, they found the other four.
Now, the two guys that were... Now, some of the other people, I don't remember if it was the people down the ravine, were wearing the clothes of the guys that were...
That were by the fire.
By the fire. Now, much has been made of that. That could be a couple different things. Sometimes, you know, when you're out in the field, some of your clothes will get wet, and your buddies will loan you something dry...
Yeah.
To put on, until your wet clothes dry off. So maybe they had exchanged clothes before this disaster happened. That's one possibility. Another possibility is that a person dying of hypothermia may have passed those bodies at the tree. They were already dead, and they took some clothing off of them to try to keep themselves alive a little bit longer. Now you might be asking, well, why didn't they just go back to their camp? Maybe they couldn't see it. They couldn't find it. Maybe they got disoriented. They didn't know where they were. You're about half crazy. You're so cold that you're almost crazy. You can't think right. You can't think right.
Well, because you got to think, they cut their way out of the tent. They were panicking. They must have thought it was an avalanche. Like, they didn't have any of their stuff. They didn't have... All their stuff was still in the tent.
Right.
All they had was what they had been wearing.
They would have only run from that collapsed tent if they thought a wall of snow was coming their way.
Yeah, that's pretty much the only thing that would have done that.
I think that's the only thing that it could have happened.
It must have collapsed on them, and they thought, we're going to die in here.
There must be more coming. You know, this is only the small part of it. The rest of the mountain's going to come down any minute. Let's run. Which that would only buy you a few minutes anyway, because if that mountain comes down on you, you're going to die eventually anyway, because all your stuff's going to be lost.
Right.
But it's just instinct. You know.
Obviously, you're not going to just like lay there and let it hit you.
Right.
I mean, you know, you're not really thinking about it at the time. You don't think about it till later.
But you just don't run from your own shoes unless you think something's going to come down. And they must have thought that the mountain
Now, I think that
on.
One of them actually had one shoe on. Which leads me to believe, well, he had the wherewithal to think, oh, I got to put my shoes on, but then he didn't have time to find the other one.
He must have pulled one on and then everybody's like,
we gotta go.
Yeah.
You know, so that's probably what happened there. But like I said, you know, over the years, there have been like a lot of stuff about, oh, the KGB didn't want to do this and they didn't release the information.
The KGB didn't have motive.
But see, I don't really think, I mean, why would they kill them? Like I said, if they did kill them, like I said, there's probably no reason.
They weren't enemies of the state.
No.
So there were, and two of them were working in the nuclear materials project. Right. So no, the KGB, if anything, the KGB just didn't want any questions asked. They didn't want any attention in that area because they were doing rocket testing in that area.
Yeah. See, I buy that.
You know,
might be the only reason they were being shifty about it was just because, oh, well, we have a secret facility not far from there. We don't want people poking around up there.
Yeah.
Too
right.
Much.
Yeah. Keep this quiet. Yeah. You know?
I mean, like I said, if they had wanted those people dead,
You never would have found the bodies
because that shit happens all the time. People go up in the mountains. Like I said, people go up and climb like K2 or whatever like that. And then they're missing and they don't find their body until like 70 years later. They find it frozen down in a fucking ravine somewhere. Or they never find it.
Yeah.
So that would have been easy if that's what they wanted to do.
Yeah. No, it was just an accident.
See, that's why I don't buy that.
I don't buy it.
And like I said, I don't buy the UFO shit either. Yeah, I know people see lights up there all the time and a lot has been made of that, but I don't know. That doesn't prove anything. Like I said, it just looks weird in hindsight.
Yeah.
If you had been there with them
and saw it happen. Yeah, you wouldn't.
I think everything would just have a normal explanation because nothing seems totally inexplicable. Like if you were asleep and half drunk in your tent and you were in your sleeping bag.
And the tent comes down on you and maybe starts filling with smoke. You're gonna panic
and you think, we gotta get out of here.
Yeah, the mountain's coming down on us.
Yeah. Which, you know, you would be right to think that because you don't wanna be fucking buried alive in a tent. Right. I don't wanna be buried alive in a tent. You're not thinking about, oh, I'm fucking my tent up and now we're screwed. You're just thinking, we don't want to get buried alive.
They really didn't run that far. It was maybe about 600 meters.
Yeah, it wasn't far. They didn't get very far.
Yeah, and they got down there near that tree line and they looked up.
And they must have realized.
They said, wait a minute, the mountain isn't coming down.
But then they're like, well, shit, now our tent's fucked up.
Yeah. We got to get back up there. They didn't make it. They got too cold.
And they didn't have enough clothes. They didn't have any shoes on. It's like they didn't. They're real. I don't know.
And I don't think they could see. Visibility must have been bad.
That's the shitty thing about it is that I don't think. I mean, once that had happened, once you thought there was an avalanche and you cut your tent open and stuff like that, in those conditions with no clothes and stuff like that, there's really not much they could have done.
No. As soon as, from my experience with really cold shit, and I've never been that undressed in that temperature. In fact, I was looking at the equipment that they carried. the equipment that I carried in the 90s was far superior. I'd never go into the field with that shit that they were wearing.
Yeah, well, it was 1959, you know.
No, you know, they didn't have polypropylene. They didn't have Gore-Tex. They didn't have any of these high-tech synthetic materials, you know. When the clothes that they were wearing, when that got cold, it was hard for your body heat to heat that up.
Yeah.
And if it got wet, forget it. All right. Yeah. And that stuff wasn't really good insulating stuff that they had, not by modern standards. And long johns are next to nothing.
Yeah.
The minute they ran from that tent, all right, and covered about 100, 200 meters, they were goners. Because even
that's
if they,
what I mean. They were probably just doomed.
They were goners. Because even if they had made it the other couple hundred meters back to the tent and start putting clothes on, they'd have lost so much core body temperature, they probably wouldn't have been able to heat up their own clothes.
Yeah. Because, yeah, like you said,
if that was a 20-mile-an-hour wind on them, whoo, man,
at that
the
temperature,
wind chill,
hypothermia would have taken over. They wouldn't have had time.
I don't think they would have been able to recover their own body heat.
Because by the time, like you said, by the time they dug through the collapsed tent and found clothes and got them on, I don't think they would have had time. And that's what's kind of scary is that because they understandably thought we're going to get buried alive, we have to get out of here.
Yeah.
But that's what ended up dooming them.
The only thing that kept them alive long enough to get down to that wood line was that they were moving.
Yeah.
All right. But as soon as they stopped moving, you saw what happened to them. They just laid down, fell asleep and died.
Yeah.
And even though moving is only going to do so much, especially if there's wind chill on them. Had they kept walking, they couldn't keep walking, or they would have.
Yeah.
That's a good example. Yeah.
Like I said, they didn't.
Eventually, the wind and the cold just sucked all the life out of them.
Yeah.
They went as far as they could go. I feel sorry for them.
I know. That sucks because, like I said, it wasn't really, they didn't do anything stupid necessarily. No.
But I also kind of think, though, you know, had they, let's say they walked down to where the tree was, and then went back to the tent and then dug through all their stuff and put their clothes back on, they probably still would have died. I don't think they would have been able to recover
their
body.
That's what I mean. I don't think
that. I don't think there was enough time anyway.
No. Yeah, I think that's what doomed them once that happened. And like I said, it was understandable why they would have done that.
And they're claiming that it was 20 degrees below zero, but it probably was colder. It was probably like 30 degrees below zero, and they were on the crest of a hill. There was probably a lot of wind on them, and that wind chill, like, once that got a hold of them, that was it. There was no coming back.
Yeah. Did you ever tell that story before about when you were in Korea about how you hallucinated when it was so cold?
No, I didn't tell them that. But it was so cold, it was probably at 50 degrees below zero. I was pulling security over an M60. I was an M60 gun at the time. My AG was in a sleeping bag at the time because we were taking turns in the sleeping bag. And I was outside of it, and I looked up, and I just saw a radiant light coming over the crest of the hill up in front of me. And I realized that was the lights of the McDonald's parking lot. And then I saw myself in there drinking coffee. So I started walking to McDonald's. And then I heard somebody, Ross, where are you going? Where are you going? Somebody run down the hill after me. And I said, going to McDonald's, man. McDonald's where? And he goes, over there. And I'm pointing at the lights. You know, you can see the light shining up. And there was no light shining up over there.
Yeah, of course not.
But I could see it. It's over there. See it? Man, there's no McDonald's, man. We're right here outside the DMZ, man. We're in Korea. Oh, yeah. I got to go back in, man. You're getting a sleeping bag. I got to go. Yeah. Got cold. Got cold and started to see McDonald's. Saw it in my mind.
It McDonald's coffee, yeah.
But a lot of guys would do that. Sometimes you'd be walking, and we had these things on the back of our helmets called cat eyes. And they were just little rectangles of green glowing plastic. And I was, and when you're walking at night, the other guy's in front of you, I think he's 10 meters in front of you, and you just see those bouncing green glowing things, little triangles, or not triangles, but rectangles. And all of a sudden they just turn into like the angry eyes of a tiger staring at me. And I just stop and freeze. And the guy behind me watches, says, Ross, what's wrong? He goes, look at that. Look, that's a tiger. I said, what are you talking about? And I snapped out of it and it vanished.
Yeah.
Oh, no, nothing. Come on. I had to run up there and go catch up to the guy.
But see, it just goes to show that even when you have like gear and you have cold weather shit on, when you're outside in the cold
for a long period of time and you're tired,
you will see shit.
Yeah.
So, I wouldn't hate on these poor people like thinking they did something. I don't think they did anything stupid. It was just a sad circumstance that probably once they cut the tent open,
that tent open and ran about 300 yards or 300 meters from that tent, they were gone or they weren't coming back. I think they lost too much body heat.
Yeah. And it's, you know, it's
and
a sad
with the equipment
story.
They were wearing, I don't think they could have recovered their body heat.
Yeah. And they're still, like I said, there's
not
a lot
in
of,
that wind chill, I don't think.
No. And like I said, there's, you know, there's a memorial there to them, and with all their pictures on it over there in Russia. And there's, it's actually kind of a popular story. It kind of seeped into the public consciousness, made a couple movies about it.
And I think the two guys that were by the tree that they found with no clothes on, those are the ones that were drinking the alcohol. That's why you're not supposed to drink alcohol in cold weather. They died first, I bet you.
They probably did, yeah. Yeah. But didn't they have burns on them too, didn't they?
And they? Evidently, they were trying to stick their feet into the fire.
Because they were so cold, yeah.
And I think those are the ones that had third-degree frostbite. That's frozen to the bone. Yeah. That means no longer, they didn't have feet anymore.
Yeah.
If they had been recovered and gone back to the rear, you know, and got to a medical facility, they just would have amputated those feet. Their feet were just frozen blocks of meat, like something you'd pull out of a freezer.
Yeah.
Yeah. So now they were gone. Because
man, the pictures from it, even though they're black and white, they're still pretty gruesome.
The three that were up close to the camp, I think they made it down to the wood line and walked back.
And then were trying to get back.
Trying to get back
because it seemed like they were trying to get back to the camp. And
they probably passed the guys that were at the tree. They were probably already dead.
Yeah, they might have been.
Or they just looked at them and went, "Those guys are goners. We can't help them."
Yeah.
Because they were too weak to carry them. They're not going to carry them, and they probably wouldn't come.
Yeah.
Come on, let's go. No, I'm all right. I'm all right. Go ahead.
I'm really sleepy.
I'm okay. Yeah. They're probably like that.
Yeah.
And then they were, there's the tent. It's got to be up here somewhere. Maybe they couldn't see the tent. They were just knew the general direction and distance. And then they just started dropping one by one. And, you know, you're too weak to stop and go, come on, let's go. Because you're really just worrying about yourself at that point.
Yeah.
I'm going to make it. But nah, they were too cold.
Yeah. Yeah, but, you know, it's a sad story. But like I said, I think people are making it into something more mysterious than it actually is.
The power of cold. That's what got them.
Yeah. Like I said, the only thing that's a mystery, I think, is what prompted them to cut the tent open. And I think there's probably a reasonable explanation.
The tent collapsed because of snow.
Yeah, that's what I think.
Yeah.
And like I said, it may be filled with smoke also.
Yeah, it may be filled with smoke because of the furnace, not my furnace, what do they call it? The heater thing.
Stove heater. Stove, I think actually Igor Dyatlov had actually made that. That was of his own design.
Bad idea.
I think he had taken it on previous trips.
Bad idea. You never have an open flame inside a tent.
Yeah.
Because
they could
kill
you. You know, they were freezing their asses off, so I guess they didn't complain.
They shouldn't have been out there.
But no, I know.
That's like those suckers that go out on the ocean on those little boats. You shouldn't be out there.
That's where the sharks live.
All you gotta do is just watch I Shouldn't Be Alive. All right, that the series I Shouldn't Be Alive, and watch what happens to you when you go out in the ocean.
See, this is why every time we see an episode of that show, I always say to Tom, "It's like let's never go out on the ocean.
Never go out on the ocean.
Let's never go out on the ocean.
Ocean's not for me.
No, that's like I said,
water everywhere, not a drop of drink.
That's where the sharks live, and that's where the giant squids live.
Yes,
and probably there's a Kraken and Godzilla and all kind of shit. I'm not going out there.
It's the wettest desert in the world. You can't drink any of that.
Nope.
No. We gotta go.
Yeah. It's the end of the show. All right. So I hope you enjoyed this take on the mysterious.
Yeah, we kind of rambled. We didn't really know how we were gonna set this up. I think we did okay with that.
Yeah, we always
just
ramble.
A response. Don't buy into that. There's paranormal stuff, but the Dyatlov Pass isn't one of them.
Yeah, I think it's just a sad, tragic story. Yeah. It was just a terrible accident, and you know that's all it was. I think.
Yeah.
And you know, since I'm always doing this little song thing at the end, and because I got started doing that, so now I got to do it forever apparently. Yeah. And I couldn't think of anything, but then I thought, oh, I like Leonard Cohen. Let's put Leonard Cohen's Avalanche on there. That'll be funny.
I don't know that one.
So I'm going to... Oh, it's a good song. Nick Cave did a cover. I was going to put the Nick Cave cover, but I decided to do the Leonard Cohen one because I thought people would be more familiar with it.
Okay.
So we're going to put that on there. Let me mention Project Entertainment Network again and say to go to their Patreon. Go do it. Also, we have t-shirts at zazzle.com/13o'clock. Go to our Twitter page or our Facebook page at 13 o'clock podcast. Give us a like or a follow, and that'll do it for this week's episode, and we'll see you next Tuesday.
I stepped into an avalanche. It covered up my soul. When I am not this hunchback that you see, I sleep beneath the golden hill. You who wish to conquer pain, you must learn to serve me well.